One of the reasons that I'm doing this work, I'm able to do it, is because I'm able to say the things that the ego finds utterly offensive, totally offensive, even though it's not offensive to truth. But the ego is very easily upset and angered, especially when you talk about how it's trying to make death real and how that's a complete waste of time. Ultimately, the purpose of the ego is to make death real so that then the overcoming of death can be real too, meaning the overcoming of annihilation. Annihilation of reality. Ego cannot make death real. It's impossible. So we have to point out, let's not spend our time trying to accomplish the impossible. And in doing so, of course, we bring up what the ego's plans are, and it doesn't like that. It says you're being very rude, very disrespectful, etc., etc., etc. And people are who feel they're scared to really speak up. They're intimidated. The ego is extremely intimidating. The plan to make death reels is extraordinarily vicious and intimidating. So it's rare that anyone can speak up here in this world. It's quite rare. It doesn't make me special at all. It's just simply that I just had I have a history of being able to do that. And in this lifetime, for a long time I couldn't, because the intimidation was too severe. But I'm able to now. Recovered, sort of recovering my voice. I didn't used to care, you know, what people thought of what I said or whatever. Just speak the truth. But it's tough. It's very tough. So for those who are not able to speak the truth, they know what the truth is, but they're thinking, oh my gosh, I better not say anything. It's a big help to have somebody speak up, because it helps you from getting too depressed. You say, it is possible. It is possible to stand up to the ego and what it's really all about, and just dismiss it entirely with love, with understanding, with clarity, not with hatred, not with confrontation, not with attack, any of that stuff. Now, one of the great problems we have in this world is that those on the spiritual path are frustrated because it doesn't happen quick enough for them. They don't get healed. It doesn't happen. And they say, look, I've learned it. I know I've learned it, and it hasn't happened. What's the problem? There's something wrong. It doesn't work. Let's look at that. What is the problem? What I say to everyone is that whatever you learn, you must overlearn, which means you must learn it over and over and over and over and over and over and over. That's called overlearning. Why? Because the crazy lessons that we've taught ourselves, that we have to make death real, we've overlearned those lessons to an extreme extent. So, in fact, we are most familiar with the principle of overlearning. And if something isn't overlearned, we don't think it can't be real, it can't be relevant, it can't be valuable, it can't be useful. We judge something in that way. So if we just learn something once, say, okay, I got it, then some part of us will say, hey, how can that be helpful if it's not overlearned? So we're wrapped up in overlearning. And that's something that I don't know, it's very rarely spoken about, but it's super important. We're wrapped up in overlearning. We dwell in a realm of overlearning where we, of course, what can you do when you're trying to accomplish the impossible? What can you do except to keep trying to learn it? So you overlearn. And we're used to that. And it doesn't work, of course, but we're used to it. Totally value it. We think overlearning equals value. Underlearning equals no value. Well, what do we do then? It's a big problem. Actually, we could be enlightened this very moment if it weren't for this problem of overlearning, because we can get it. We can get it right now. We can. But we'll say, some part of us will say, oh, wait a minute. That can't be true, because you only got it once. You need to get it a million times. And only then will it have any value to you. So that's a sticking point, of course. Any one of us can get a boom, okay? Can get it, can go to a retreat, can go to get a guru, contact high something, and we can be pushed through for a moment and get it. But that doesn't stick. And then we kind of feel like, various stuff happens when we come down from that. And none of it good, really. Rarely. So it should be a basic premise of the spiritual path. One that must be emphasized from the very beginning is you need to overlearn it. You need to overlearn it all. And that's what I've done. It's taken me so long. And why? Because I've been overlearning it. I go over the same lessons over and over and over and over. Constantly, all day long, I am going over something. Constantly. Been doing that for 35 years. Constantly going over the same material or similar material over and over, nonstop. And you wonder, how come it hasn't set yet? Because it's the overlearning problem. It's that issue of overlearning. It's not a real problem, but it's a practical problem. Now, the fact is that what the best path is, the path that I'm advocating is really the best, is it you come to look at the whole spiritual path as simply an exercise in total practicality. Total pragmatism. Pure pragmatism is the answer for all of us. It makes it so much easier. No mysticism, no esotericism, no airy fairy stuff, you know. It's just absolutely practical. The vision of Christ, the overlay, which is the goal for us, is actually the perfect antidepressant. It is the antidepressant pill that all the pharmaceutical companies are working, trying to get materially, trying to devise something that works. The vision of Christ is the perfect antidepressant. And we all deserve that, because we're all depressed, actually. Some worse than others, but we are all actually profoundly depressed. Some just realize it, and most don't realize it. But almost without exception on this planet, except for those who have awakened and accepted, switched hypothetical scenarios, and are dwelling in the vision of Christ, the overlay, we're all super depressed, super depressed. Occasionally, there are some who get just even worse, which is what happened to me. Even worse than just normal super depression. Mega super depression. And then they say, whoa, I can't handle this. And I gotta find an antidepressant that works. And none of the stuff really works. Because when you get super mega depressed, you're not satisfied with ordinary depression, going back into just regular super depression. You say, no, because the mega super could come back. It could reestablish itself. And you say, I can't have that. So you begin to search for the true antidepressant. Where is the, you know, Ponce de Leon was searching for the fountain of youth. And he didn't find it, but there was this legend, the fountain of youth. Well, what we're searching for is the perfect antidepressant, really. We're all searching for that. And I know it exists. I know it's real. I know it can be found. But the overlearning issue gets in our way. It blocks us. And it's the darndest thing, because there's no way around it. There is just simply no way around it. Which is why the real great spiritual teachers tell us we have to, essentially their message is we have to overlearn it all. Which is why they say, expect to spend a lifetime at it. Make it your career. Make it a lifetime, if you want, hobby. You know, some people spend more time at their hobby than they do their job. You can still have a job. But the spiritual path is your true career. It has to be. The search for that perfect antidepressant has to be your career. Meaning, as you're doing your job, as you're going about your life, you are overlearning, 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 overlearning. Which probably means you will not be holding a high position in this world, because your attention is not riveted on success in this world, worldly success. It's riveted on find that perfect antidepressant. So you will simply spend your time, no matter what you're doing, you will just be overlearning, 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 going over and over and over and over in your mind, quietly, silently, just reminding yourself. Keep reminding yourself. That's the only thing that really works. So the great teachers are super practical. They don't come promise you pie in the sky, like, yeah, just come and see me and I'll give you, boom, Shakti pot, and that's it. That's all you need. You're enlightened. That may work for somebody who has spent a lifetime in overlearning, but if you haven't spent your time in overlearning, it's not going to work. You might have a brief moment, as it were. But then the issue of overlearning creeps right back in and says, hey, wait a minute. Yeah, this is too fragile. It'll say that. It'll say, whoa, this is way too fragile. You need to work on making it real. Because Of course, all our overlearning has been to try and make death real. So we think that nothing can be real unless it's overlearned to an incredible extent. And it's so frustrating because you know what the truth is. And yet there's something within you that's saying, no. No, it's not real yet. It's not real yet. You can't trust it. It's still a dream. It's still just your imagination. It's not real yet. So you can look at reality and insist, no, it's not real yet because it's not been overlearned. So that is what slows us down. That is, it's the most maddening thing. And that's why sometimes the gurus give you the japa, the repetition. What they're doing is getting you into the overlearning thing, the overlearning situation. Say, so just keep repeating it. Repeat it millions and millions and millions of times. And at some point you'll say, oh, I've learned enough. There's something that clicks and says, okay, I bet it's real now. Even though it's been real all along. It's been there all the time. What we mean really, we say, I bet it's valuable to me now. I bet it's useful to me now. It's been useful to us the entire time. The vision of Christ, switching hypothetical scenarios so that you see no death anywhere. You have no need to make death real. And you can see, allow everything to be exquisitely beautiful. Because you're not trying to say, I got to make death real. I got to make this seem more alive so then it can die, so it can make death real. No, everything's equally, perfectly, exquisitely beautiful. And in order to make that seem valuable to us, we feel we have to overlearn the way to get there. So we can know the way to get there. I do know. I know all this. I know exactly what it's all about. And yet the overlearning problem still persists. Just as it persists for everybody, almost everybody. And those who finally make the breakthrough, it's because they've overlearned it to such an amazing extent. And if they do it early in life, it's because in a previous life they overlearned it. Really, there is virtually no remedy for it. It's the darnest thing. It's so frustrating. As a teacher, you're frustrated because you think, you know, I can tell you the truth right this moment. And you can understand it this very moment. But next moment you'll say, oh, wait a minute. It can't possibly be useful yet. We need to say it again, hear 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 it a million times. So from a practical standpoint, overlearning is the answer. You could say overlearning is the answer from a practical standpoint. Without it, you're just going to continue to dwell in the realm of trying to make death real, which is very nasty. Now to get to the news, I'm thinking of kind of making this an evening broadcast instead of a counter-programming to what's on the television and all the channels, etc. You can watch this channel, and I will make it like an hour or hour something program, as if you were watching some nightly news plus the afternoon talk show humor kind of stuff, whatever it calls itself. You can spend an hour watching this instead of an hour watching television. So I can touch on the news, I can throw stuff in there, make it some sort of format. So the news, what do you start off with the news? You can start off every day with the shooting du jour, right? There's always a shooting du jour. But what's more interesting is what's behind the shooting du jour. Now, if you look back on the inauguration day, which is actually Sunday, the January 20th, it's amazing. Right after, when I was here on the West Coast, I didn't even know that I didn't know the inauguration was going to take place. I thought it was on Monday. And around 9:30-ish or something, I suddenly got hit with all this belligerence and this attitude, and I lost my poise. I got out of character. I said, and other people were that way, and it was like horrible day. I said, wow, it's a terrible day. I was distraught at the end of the day. I said, what happened to me? It started right just past 9 o'clock West Coast time. Now, did you know that prior to 12 noon East Coast time was when the swearing-in ceremony took place of the president? So just after that happened, I suddenly am experiencing this unbelievable situation where I'm moved to belligerence, which is tough to do for me, very tough. And I was shocked. I haven't acted that way in the longest time, really. I was very confrontational. And I said, wow. I went back. I said, what's happened to my spiritual path? What happened to all my poise? All everything I've learned? How could I step out of character like that? That is absolutely nuts. And then next day, the 21st, which is the big ceremony thing, again, people starting to act out of character to extreme extent, very confrontational, very belligerent. I said, wow. On the night of Sunday, what happened was, going back to Sunday, on the true inauguration day, I suddenly felt a thought form, like trying to come into me. A thought form. I said, this is a kind of thought form. And actually, it happened in church before I got home. But when I got home, a thought form came to me. I realized, I said, this isn't my thought. And the thought says, I'm going to die of a heart attack. I'm going to die of a heart attack. I said, wait a minute. I've never think that way. That's not me at all. I don't think that way. And those things never crossed my mind. I said, this is not true. I said, where is this coming from? And I kept saying, I'm going to die of a heart attack. As if this I am going to die, it was my thought. Because when you say I am something, you think it must be your thought. It wasn't my thought at all. It wasn't my thought. I said, what the hell? Where is this thought coming from? And I dismissed it. I said, no, that's not true. It's not true. I refused to entertain it. You see, if I thought it was my thought, I would have entertained it. I said, something is alerting me. I must be ready to die of a heart attack and start panicking. In other words, my intuition is speaking to me. I said, no, that's not my intuition. That is not me. And earlier in church, the same thing happened. I heard this thought very clearly express itself to me. It said, Jesus, murder me. Jesus, murder me. It's like someone pleading for Jesus to murder them. I said, that's not me. That's not my thought. That's the last thing in the world I would ever say. That is complete, can't possibly be my thought. I said, this is some thought form that is trying to make me think that I'm the one thinking it. I said, no, I dismissed it. And then again, it says, I'm going to die of a heart attack. I'm going to die of a heart attack. And then the idea came to me, like in a thought form came and said, I'm not going to survive the night. I'm going to die tonight. I'm not going to live through the night. I said, no, that's also nonsense. I said, what in the world is going on? What in the world? And the next day, a lot of problems and people reacting in severely belligerent, confrontational, just like, wow. I said, what is going on? Well, I started to think about all the videos that I've made and how I talked about the what's going to happen on Inauguration Day. I said, you better be ready for January 21st, Inauguration Day, because on that day, there's going to be this a blitzkrieg. And I kind of put that in the back of my mind. There's going to be a subtle blitzkrieg is going to take place. That those who are behind this whole push to make death real, I've talked about the draconians and those of a certain mindset who function on the psychic level of the mind, as it were. Mind really has no levels, but because we are in using self-deception on ourselves, we believe the mind has levels. So we talk about the psychic level or something. Well, I can tell you what happened now, because I knew ahead of time what was going to happen, but I kind of forgot about it. So I didn't put two and two together right away. I said there was going to be an extreme blitzkrieg on a psychic level, and it could be unleashed on the world, on the subtle level. See, these entities function at the psychic level, and they use psychic warfare. They're very adept at psychic warfare. And they attain their aims by trying to get people they project thought forms. Thought forms are actually things. They're just as much things as stuff you see in your room. It's just that they're subtle to our perception. They're subtle. But of course, to seeing things not through the perception of the body's eyes, but of the mind seeing itself, as it were, they're just as non-subtle as a rock or something. It's the same thing. They're thought forms, they're things, like viruses or something. And what these entities do, who are basically situated more at the psychic level than we are used to, although many of us also are psychic. I was very psychic, still am. And the psychic isn't bad. It can be used for clarification, or it can be used for self-deception. Yeah, either way. It's just a capability of the mind, of actually the imagining of the mind is a capability. So what these entities have done, who are here, who are really in control of this planet now, and they timed it just right at the inauguration time, right at that time, it's all been pre-planned, as I saw ahead of time, this is what they're going to do, is they unleash this ferocious barrage of psychic artillery, as it were, which are thought forms. And these thought forms come in the form of, I am going to die of a heart attack, something like that. I am. That's a thought form. And psychic thought forms can spread over the world, boom, very quickly. The speed of thought, almost. Being forms, they don't quite move like that, but they go quickly. They go quickly. They spread quickly. I don't know how long it takes. It takes maybe, you know, I'm just guessing, but it might take a minute, 5 minutes, ten, half an hour or something to cover the entire globe, or an hour. I don't know. It's not quite the speed of light, because thought forms do have, there are things, and they do have laws of motion and inertia, all this kind of stuff. So I'm not exactly sure how fast it goes, especially these heavy, terrible, dense thought forms. So they unleash this massive barrage of thought forms around the whole globe. And so I'm sitting there at my desk, and suddenly this thought suddenly, like a bell, ring, 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 you know, ring, 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 someone knocking on your door. And this thought says, I'm going to die of a heart attack. And I say, huh? What? Where did that come from? I started looking at, what? Where? What? What's that all about? What? That's, and yes, and then again, I'm going to die of a heart attack. And I said, kind of got a little frightened. I said, wait, who? What's this about? Where's this coming from? I feel fine. There's nothing wrong with my health. I'm poised. I'm calm. Sure, I'm stressed out. But I said, that doesn't sound right. That doesn't sound right. It doesn't quite sound like my intuition talking, speaking to me. It's some. What's going on? So I rejected it. It took a little effort, and it took a lot of will and focus and determination just to say, forget it. I said, well, if I do, I do. If I don't, I don't. I'm not going to scare myself like that. Something's weird going on here. That was a thought form that these psychic entities, the draconians, reptilians, and those who work for them, the greys, etc., unleashed upon the world in a blitzkrieg. We talk about the Nazi blitzkrieg going into Austria, or Czechoslovakia, Hungary, all this kind of stuff, right? They unleashed a certain moment, they unleashed this incredible blitzkrieg. Well, I told you, the blitzkrieg that's coming now is subtle. It's subtle. It's on the level of thought forms. And so then the next day this continued, and people who internalized this stuff and thought it was their thoughts began reacting to it, becoming very reactive to it. And of course they've been doing this for a long time here, which is why you have these shootings. As a matter of fact, these shootings are people who've been targeted with these psychic thought forms, who are too weak, and they take it in and they think that it's their own thoughts. And then these thoughts build up this complex within themselves, and they become crazy, and they go start shooting people. That's exactly how it works. It's intentional. Thought forms are being sent out. The warfare in this world right now is psychic warfare. It's psychic warfare, and we need shields for that. We really need shields. The more we realize what's going on, the more we'll be able to find the right kind of shielding that we need. So, I spoke a year ago or more. I said these shootings are going to become more and more and more frequent, worse and worse and worse. And I said there'll become a time where we'll have shootings every day, and maybe multiple shootings every day. And literally, that's actually where we're at right now. We have like a shooting a day almost, right? I mean, I don't pay attention to the media news at all, but occasionally when I'm surfing the web, some little snippet will come up. It's hard to avoid everything, or somebody else will mention something to me on a job or something, you know, it'll filter through, and I say, oh, another shooting, okay, of course, because the psychic warfare that's going on, those people who are already destabilized, how do you become destabilized to these thought forms? Well, that's a lot of what I have done in all these videos, is to help shield you from these psychic thought forms, and tell you what to stay away from, because there's certain things that will destabilize you and make you vulnerable to misinterpreting, thinking these thoughts are your own thoughts when they're really not, making you think that these thoughts are super important to act upon when they're not at all. And so these people who are weak have been being undermined, continuously undermined by the habits that they have, habits in life, by the entertainment. The media entertainment and empire is really an effort to destabilize the planet and make us vulnerable to these thought forms. And ultimately the purpose is these thought forms, when they become internalized in this population enough, is to create massive warfare and destruction here. Massive, intense death. See, the idea of the ego is to make death real. It thinks that the more vicious the death, the more real it, the more chance it has of making it real. So the more incredible violence there is, the more the ego thinks, that's going to make it real. So The attempt is to make the turn this planet into a state of just abject warfare. Horrendous stuff. You see these mass shootings, just horrendous stuff. It's just slaughter. You know, it's attempt to just turn this, and it's been going on in Mexico for a long time, actually, of people just walking into restaurants, teenagers with automatic weapons, and just simply opening fire on everybody, just killing everybody in cold blood, and just walking out like it's nothing. That's been going on for quite some time. It's just, I mean, the stuff in Mexico is unbelievable. The dismemberment, the slaughter there, it's just every day that there's people just discarding chopped up bodies on the roadways, just right in the middle of traffic or restaurant traffic. That's an attempt to destabilize the planet. And these people are doing that, have been infected with these thought forms, intentionally infected with them. Why? By using drugs like methamphetamine. All drugs make you super vulnerable to this. Even stimulants, all the stimulants, even coffee, cigarettes, coffee, all that alcohol, all that stuff makes you very, very vulnerable. And then you have all the media, all the entertainment, you have all of that also makes you extremely vulnerable. The movies, the video games make you extremely vulnerable. They destabilize you to a point where you have a hard time determining between what your thoughts are and what these thought forms, that these psychic thought forms that are like weapons being pushed upon you. You can't differentiate. You think, this is my thought, therefore I need to act upon it. So, you know, methamphetamine and drugs like that are a horrendous problem around the world, actually, and it's spreading all faster and faster and faster. If you want to see what the world's going to be like, let's look at Mexico, all right? Because that a lot of people down there, young people, are methamphetamine, cocaine, pot, but it's mostly the drugs like cocaine and methamphetamine. And those really nasty synthetic types of drugs really severely lower you. Now pot is also very troublesome. It can give you a false sense of being shielded. Okay, it kind of does that. So you really think, oh, I'm shielded, when you're not. You're not. So it's a subtler thing. It's a subtler thing. It's sort of a mellow thing. Like it's kind of like it induces some sort of naivete, really. So that's why pot is really bad, because of the naivete it induces. You're easily pulled into other stuff, and you think, oh no, I'm okay, nothing's bad's happened, no problem here, and then you get destabilized that way. So it's a sort of a subtle stealth kind of drug, actually. And of course, I don't know if I've ever met a pothead in my life who spoke negatively about it. They all defend it with their lives, you know. They say, oh no, there's nothing wrong. It's not true, because it induces this naivete, which seems like strength. You see, I'm very passive, I'm very mellow, I'm very nice, no, everything's fine. And then you find that they get into more and more stuff, which is actually very destabilizing. So no drugs are good at all. None of the entertainment is good. The news, all this stuff, it's wicked, absolutely wicked. It's intentionally designed by these psychic entities. The whole superstructure of entertainment and news and popular culture and drugs and pornography and music and on and on and on is all designed by these psychic entities to destabilize the planet, to undermine our resistance, to these thought forms that they are unleashing now and have been projecting into the world. But now they unleash the blitzkrieg, which I said would happen January 21st. I said on inauguration day the blitzkrieg would be unleashed, and you had better be shielded by that time. That's probably the rainstorm that I saw this rainstorm that was the most ferocious thing I've ever seen. And I was in a house that had a roof, and the house stood and didn't cause any problem for me. But I went outside afterwards, and my God, it wreaked so much damage. Now, I don't know if that was the entire next 4 years, or was that the blitzkrieg that happened on inauguration day, and during the and Sunday and Monday, actually. Ferocious. And so you may hear this, you say, oh my gosh, and stuff starts clicking to say, oh, okay, I see what's going on. You're starting to see what's really going on here. It's hard to talk about to most people, because they think you're nuts. What are you talking about? ETs and psychic realm and thought forms and projecting thought forms and undermining our stability, blah, 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 blah. But this is absolutely accurate and true. This is what happens. It's just that we are, in our effort to make death real, we tend to think that the mind is fragmented. So, and we think that the way to make death real is to be unaware of anything else that's going on in the mind. And so we just see a little part of it, and we think that's going to make it very successful. So a lot of us don't even aren't aware of the psychic realm, aren't aware of the various aspects of the mind, the totality of it. We don't even aware of it. We insist it doesn't exist. That's a strategy. That's a strategy, actually. And we dumb ourselves down, thinking that if we're really, really dumb, then somehow death's going to become real. And also, if we're very vulnerable to other aspects of the mind, like the psychic attacks, then that'll make death real. So most of us think this is all nonsense. Oh, there's nothing going on like that. But if you don't want to make death real, then there's no reason to see the mind as fragmented. You can see the totality of the mind, everything it's doing, everything that's going on. There's no levels, no real levels in the mind at all. It's just our own taboos that make it seem like that. And our attempt to dumb ourselves down and make ourselves vulnerable, etc., etc., brings about that so-called imaginary stratification of the mind, but it's not stratified. So these psychic attacks have been planned for a long time. And of course, there are those who are aware of the mind. They're totally aware that this is. And you think Jesus can look at the mind? He knows exactly what's going on. There's no secrets there. There's no secrets in the mind. The mind doesn't have any secrets. We're just trying to imagine their secrets as if there's some secret there that can, secret can make death real. And we just don't dare look there or something. Or else we'll lose its effect if we look at it. So we don't look. We don't look behind the doors of the mind. You know, behind that door, don't open it up. Don't look. Because if it does, that'll ruin the magic. Now, what we'll see is that it's all imagination. It's all nonsense. So, and then we think, uh-oh, we won't be able to make death real because it's only imaginary. You see, the reason why we want to make death real is so that we can, say, survive what's a real happening, you know, the destruction of reality. Because if it's just symbolic, the survival of death doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean anything. And we know that. We say, it's useless. If death is just, we're just imagining it, then this contingency plan is just imaginary. It's not real. So it's useless. So we know that in order for this contingency plan to be useful, we have to make death real. We have to. That's the all-important issue. And so that's what we're trying to do. So, of course, this psychic attack on this planet has been planned for a long time, and a lot of people have gone along with it and helped it along by undermining our resistance to it through all the media, entertainment, all these folks have gone along with it and prepared for it. And now it's being unleashed like a blitzkrieg. It makes the Nazi blitzkrieg look like a church social, really, if you really look at the situation. It's way more vicious. Way more vicious. Because it's trying to engulf the world in savagery, really. The goal is engulf the world in savagery. Because you see, these killings are absolutely insane, right? There's no honor there. It's not two combatants in an arena, you know, both with armor and swords, and there's no zero compassion, zero humility. It is simply like a complete insane savagery. That's their goal. That is their goal. It's just aimless, randomless, you know, practice random acts of savagery is what they're really saying. Instead of practice random acts of kindness, which is what we should be doing, which is what this planet used to be doing a lot more, I can tell you that for sure. I mean, that's how I was raised. That's how most people were raised. My practice random acts of kindness. You just see, it's automatic. You see somebody, you first thing comes to your mind, what act of kindness can I do in that situation? That is how we're raised. If you're raised properly, you see somebody, first thing is anything that I can, what kind, anything I can do? Anything I can do? What can I do that's kind? Whatever it is, something small, something big, whatever. And then people do that to you, and that's how you build community. That's how you get people to start focusing on salvation. Okay, they say, hey, maybe it is possible. Maybe we don't need to make death real. Maybe death can't be made real. Maybe there's a way. God's made a way for us to drop the attempt and be reminded of a reality. And there is a way, of course. So we've gone from practicing random acts of kindness to practicing random acts of savagery, which is what these ETs who want to take over this planet are all about. And of course, it's more than just take over this planet. They want to get the power. of making death real, because then if they feel then they will become the new prime creators, because they will then be able to resurrect the dead, bring the dead back to life. They have technology to do that kind of stuff. But the problem is that they know there's something within them that still saying that this is not real. So they say, they're so frustrated. They say, we got to have more death. We have to have more savagery. We got to make it real. And so they're planning this to turn the world into just a place of utmost savagery. As again, in Mexico, they've gone a long way toward that, subverting and undermining the culture. And of course, you see, the thing in Mexico is, people point out how harmless pot is. It's not true, because it grows wild there. There's so much marijuana, so much pot in Mexico. It's all free. I mean, the villagers, the people live the thing. They use it. The older people use it. People use it all the time for free. It's their tobacco. It's cheap tobacco for them. Cheap tobacco, and they use it to treat all sorts of illnesses, etc., etc. So you have a culture down there that is smoking pot all the time. And to them, it's no big deal, nothing. This is just, you know, it's just fine. This is just something nature provides for us, and helps us with something to make mellow, whatever. But from that culture comes this younger culture now of getting into harder and harder and harder drugs, you see. And it lessens your resistance to harder drugs. It absolutely does. Absolutely does. Because you think, hey, there's nothing wrong with this, so there's another drug, probably nothing wrong with that either, kind of thing. It's a slippery slope. So you have in Mexico, it is just this absolutely insanely savage situation that is just mind-numbingly crazy, because so many people are on, you know, cocaine and methamphetamine, etc., etc., and they grow up playing these super violent video games. They grow up, you know, idolizing these drug kingpins, etc., etc. And for them, it's practicing random acts of savagery to them is like their salvation. They see it as their salvation. They worship the goddess of death down there, really. And that's a precursor of what the planet is going to become like. Random acts of savagery. And so that's what we're seeing now happen on a daily basis in the good old U.S. of A., which is, of course, the last place you think that would ever happen. I mean, growing up in my generation, could anyone ever envision that such a thing could ever possibly happen? And the truth is, I actually knew it would, because I was able to see psychically. I was able to see the future, and I knew it was coming. And so I tried to tell people, warn people, and people said I was nuts. I said, this can never happen here. It will never happen. I mean, what is happening right now in the United States of America? If you took the headlines of a month here and you transposed those back in time to 19 or early 1960s, for instance, or whatever, late 1950s, 60s, even the 70s, whatever. If someone read those headlines, they would say, this is total science fiction. This is no possibility this could ever happen. None. Zero. This is complete make-believe. It'll never happen. So imagine how difficult it was for me to try to warn people. This is like impossible. Virtually impossible. You know, practically impossible. And there's a few people say, oh, man. You know, but you had to really see it. I mean, I saw it. I could see it. I could see the future. I could really see it incredibly well. It was just normal for me, just seeing the future. Well, I said, what's it? There's no difference between seeing the psychic realm and seeing this realm. The mind's all one. Mind's all one. There's no stratification of the mind. So of course you can see what's to come, what the psychic is happening at the psychic level, what their intentions are, and even you can see the future, how it's going to play out, all that stuff. Easy. So I saw it all coming. My spiritual mentors told me it's coming, and I tried to help warn people. Fell on deaf ears. So the headlines of today, just like, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? No way. It's taken all this time, 50 years or more of intense effort to undermine the United States of America and the globe in general, to undermine the resistance to all this random acts of savagery. It's taken super huge effort on the part of these aliens, really, who started showing up here in mass towards the end of the war, World War II, and started making deals with governments and started interacting at subtle levels and setting up shop. And they had planned this invasion for a long time. Of course, they helped trigger World War II and et cetera, et cetera. But they really were able to work the way they wanted to work very rapidly about 50 years ago. And so they've been steadily undermining our resistance to their thought forms, So we have a hard time distinguishing them. I think like a little bug flew in my mouth or tried to. Speaking of bugs, it's amazing what thought forms can do if you take them to be your own. You get sick. Literally, you get sick. You can get flu. You can get all these viruses, you know. That has a lot to do with thought forms. It's probably on a subtle level. They're thought forms on a subtle level. The thought forms have been spread around the world. They're spreading thought forms around the world. And then it makes you susceptible to these bugs, these viruses. Whereas if you don't accept the thought forms, you're not susceptible to it. Really, that's how sickness works. At the level of energy, as it were. It's all just an illusion, a mirage anyway, but that's a higher level of speaking about it, which we can certainly easily do. So you don't want to catch those bugs. But if you get an idea, I'm getting sick. Is that really your idea? Or you can check that thought form and say, no, I'm not. That's not my thought form. I refuse that thought form. I refuse all thought forms of sickness entirely. You can do that. People used to know how to do that, actually. People's immunity was actually better in the past because they knew how to, they were more shielded from these thought forms of sickness. Now, it's like we're extremely susceptible to them, but then we have all this like high medicine, all this medicine in hospitals to say, oh, it doesn't matter if I get sick. What's the big deal? I just go into the hospital or just take this medicine, etc. It is a big deal because you're getting more and more used to accepting these negative thought forms. Is that the bug? Maybe that's the bug. I don't know. There's something in there. Yeah, it's getting very buggy. It's like a thought form flying into my mouth. You think, oh, but that's food. I'm gonna eat the food. No, don't eat the food. I see it. That's a bug. I don't want that. Forget it. But if you think it's food, say, oh, this is food. So you eat it. So that's what I mean. Like the world's been undermined. is so many people now take these thought forms as nourishment. You watch all these violent video games, and a thought form comes in and says, like, I'm feeling very violent. I want to kill or something. And you think, oh, that's like nourishment for me. So I'm going to eat that, and make it part of me or something. And you think it's nourishment. I think it's food for you. And you think it's your thought, your what you want to do, what you really want to do. It's not really. Let me see. Pretty funny how those kind of synchronicities happen. Something. So, the news is relevant. The real news is very relevant. The news we hear on television is totally irrelevant. It's not telling us the story. Is it telling us the truth? Is it really telling us the truth? No, it wants death to be real too. And so, you know, the reptilians wouldn't even be here unless they were invited here because we wanted to make death real. Now, I've talked about Jesus' situation, the crucifixion, all that stuff, and it's a very strange situation, because what Christianity has become is to say that Jesus made death real, and then the resurrection means that there's a way to survive a real death, which is exactly what we're trying to do and trying to become prime creators, supplant God as prime creator. We have to change reality, which means annihilation of reality, which means in order to do this, we have to make death real and then survive it. We have to survive the annihilation of reality. So we have this hypothetical scenario where we're trying to make death real and then survive it. And we think once we do that, we can become prime creator. We can become prime creator. So they have the story of Jesus coming down as if Jesus saying Jesus is God, and that Jesus made death real. That is, that Jesus' death meant that death is real. It happens to reality. In other words, it's real. Reality was died. It means death is real. And then Jesus was resurrected, saying, oh, but it's okay. Reality can die, but there's something that will be resurrected from that. In other words, that seems to make our contingency plan work. They say, oh, we got it. So that's why Christians say, we're saved, because we got the contingency plan now. That's what they're saying. What they're really saying is, we have the contingency plan. It's already done. Done deal. Now we can go back to reality. It's all done deal. Which is, of course, completely ridiculous. But now, there is one way that you can see it where it's not quite that ridiculous. I'm trying to give some slack here, because otherwise it's really something. Of course, Christianity, those who founded it, etc., know all about the reptilians, know all about the psychic, those on the psychic levels who are trying to make death real and take over planets and induce absolute savagery on the planet. And they said, we need to block this. Well, let's block it. But they said, how do we block this? Because the people, they're going to just easily fall for it. So there's a big problem about that, really. And they were trying to figure out, how do we block it? How do we stop it? Now, it's conceivable that the Jesus situation was actually what they came up with. They said, this is a way to buy time. And it did work for a couple thousand years, actually, in part. And it's a funny thing, because what it is that the Christians say to the reptilians, they say, hey, we don't need you coming here. We've already succeeded. You see, the reptilians say, we need to come here and make death real. And the Christians say, no, you don't need to come here. You don't need to come here at all, because Jesus already succeeded. We already got the contingency plan. It's a done deal. It's already done. What are you talking about, reptilians? We don't need you. So in that way, in a curious way, Christianity did block the reptilians from coming here, because they weren't invited. Christians wouldn't invite them, because Christians would say, "What do you? We don't need it. We don't need you. We don't need you. It's already been done. It's already been accomplished. we're way ahead of you, and so there's no necessity. We're not inviting you here, because it's crazy to do something that's already been done. Once it's done, we don't need to do it anymore. And besides, we don't want to keep suffering. It's stupid. So, in a very tricky way, the whole crucifixion resurrection thing was a way to block the reptilians from coming here, because they weren't invited for a long time. But it was just buying time, because the fact is, the crucifixion resurrection didn't accomplish anything like that. Did not at all. Nothing. You can't make death real. It's impossible. And so we're still stuck with the situation of needing to give up our efforts to make death real and choose God's plan of salvation, which is to exchange hypotheticals. Which is why A Course in Miracles came into the world. As you see, is the time of blocking the reptilians, they knew it would come to an end, because gradually people would start realizing, oh my gosh, you know, this thing just doesn't work. This crucifixion resurrection thing just doesn't really work. And they'll start eroding, and the reptilians will start being invited in. And that's what happened. And so at that point, you need to go directly to the truth, no trickery at all, and have it explained to you directly that here's the real way. But see, in the past, we weren't ready for it. We're too naive. Too naive. Jesus told us that. He said, you're too naive. You're too ignorant. You can't understand what I'm saying. So I'm going to have to speak in parables. And I'm going to have to do this and this crucifixion thing and all this stuff. And later on, the Holy Spirit will clarify everything for you. And gradually, you will become able to hear it directly. So A Course in Miracles is very direct teaching. There's no trickery there. None. The nature of speech and words is such that there's a necessity, even with A Course in Miracles, to get it clarified further. But there's no trickery involved. There's no really kind of backhanded stuff like that, the crucifixion resurrection. No, there's not. Which is why I accepted it. Otherwise, I'd say, forget it. That's nonsense. we're still quite ignorant and still quite naive, so there has to be some art to the introduction of truth, even direct truth. There has to be some art to it, some. So it is presented in a way that has some strategy to it a little bit, yeah. But not bad, not too much at all, really. I mean, if you're really willing to see through all that, you can easily, you can get through it all and see the truth that is there. You absolutely can. It's not an attempt and not a trickery, because it says too late for that. It's, you know, game's up. The time that we bought through that tricky, kind of tricky strategy of the crucifixion and the resurrection is up now. It was temporary anyway. It was only a temporary expedient. That's why they said the church age is going to come to an end. And the church age has come to an end. We're at the end times now. And this is the Blitzkrieg on the inauguration day of 2013 was the beginning of the all-out troubles. Time of tribulation. It started. The trumpets actually sounded on inauguration day. And boy, did it come in with a kick. And very unwelcome, to say the least. So, those who took A Course in Miracles, like myself, was super important. Jesus has emphasized, I did have contact with Jesus, not so much recently. I'm sure there's some reason for that, because he's probably just saying, hey, you're doing fine. Just keep going for it, And but previously, I think I needed some pep talks. And I had meetings with him on the subtle level of the mind. And he just say, you got to go faster. You got to go all out as fast as you possibly can. Forget about anybody else who's doing A Course in Miracles. Forget about it. You just go as fast as you can. Don't worry about anything else. That's what he'd say. And then he'd say, faster. Come on. Forget about, don't worry about trying to memorize the book or anything. Just get it internalized and then overlearn it. In your own words, overlearn it. Fast, come on. Fast as possible. Because he knew what's coming. He knew what's coming. Absolutely knew. And yet he knew that those who could overlearn it in time would be viable here to help show others how to shield themselves, be a shielding function. And so we're in that right now. And I'm kind of disappointed that I've not had a major breakthrough. I've been having big breakthroughs for sure, but not the ultimate one, really. I haven't taken the antidepressant pill yet, the vision of Christ. I need to. I really need to, because only then will I truly be viable to shield people, help shield the world from these thought forms. We can take shelter from them. There are ways to shield it, and people need to start practicing that. That's very important, because the war is on. The war started. The all-out war started, and we don't see it yet show up physical level, but on psychic level it's shown up, and it's the psychic level that really counts, really, because once you begin accepting these thought forms as your own, they begin directing your behavior, and then you're a goner at that point. You're a robot, you're a tool. They can manipulate you psychically from a distance. The general generals of this war are not on the battlefield. They're on the psychic level manipulating what's going on the battlefield here. Just using thought forms. Telepathic commands and thought forms, all this stuff. And people think that it's their own guidance, that they're just following their own behavior, their own choices. That's not true. They're not. So, these are the situations that we're up against right now, and it's nasty. I told you it'd be nasty. It is. And yet we will get help, and I keep calling on the help. Keep calling. I'm working like crazy to be helpful. I'm telling you, but again, the overlearning problem rears its ugly head, you know? And what I do is I just try to keep saying, no, it's practical. It's just simply sheer utility is all this whole situation of God, the vision of Christ, all this stuff is simply practical. There's forget about all this emotionalism, forget about all this pomp and circumstance of spirituality. Something that I do, if I'm not taping here, you might say, what do? That's the cat. Hello, cat. Cats are actually very psychic. They function very much at the psychic level. The cats are amazing. So are dogs. Animals are amazing. They very much function at the psychic level. They're way smarter than we know. Way smarter. I'm telling you, it's just amazing. I've had cats that can absolutely read my mind. Telepathy. Absolute telepathy. I tested it out. Totally telepathic. There's one cat was so psychically smart, it made us look like, I felt like an idiot compared to that cat. Truly. Cat absolutely could read your mind. And it's amazing. What was I saying before the cat showed up? I was saying something. I don't want to get off on a tangent like that. But off is important. I'm sure it'll come back. Oh, my time. What do I do with my time? Okay. I spend a lot of time watching YouTube videos that focus on pomp and circumstance of spirituality, all that stuff that seems really glamorous about spirituality. And I just look at it, I watch it, and you may think, oh, I'm into it, oh, this is what I want. No, what I'm doing is I'm comparing it to what I do and saying, which do I like better? Which is more useful? Which is more practical? And I'm saying, wait a minute, you know, what I'm doing is more practical, is more useful, this is a better way. So I'm kind of reinforcing my own convictions that this is the better way. It's a higher way by far and away, is look at everything on a totally practical basis. What God offers us is purely practical, totally useful, that's all. It's just hypotheticals, the best they can ever be is simply useful, that's it, nothing more than that. You don't need to blow them up and put tinsel on them at all. It's not necessary. It's not necessary. So, for instance, I'm looking at the Kumbh Mela, the they call it the Maha Kumbh Mela. Some call it the Kumbh Mela, or the Purna Kumbh Mela. Purna Maha. Maha means great. Purna means complete. Complete gathering. And it's full of so much stuff, you know. And I look and I just say, good grief. Come on, are you kidding me? This is extravagant. This is so extravagant. It's not practical. It's not practical. It's not pragmatic. There's so much extravagance in women. It's so much. I mean, what? You're going to be saved by bathing in the Ganges at a particular astrological configuration? You're going to be, that's your salvation? Wash your sins away? This whole thing, wash your sins away? And you... all this, you know, stuff. I mean, that you can put silver, you can make something of it. But there's too much extravagance, too much women, that way too much, glamour, spiritual glamour. Forget it. Now for those people, you know, maybe they see it a different way or something. But it honestly, I don't see much practical utility to it at all. I really don't. In fact, that the way I look at most of the spiritual pomp and stuff, personal circumstances, not much spiritual pragmatism to it whatsoever, not much utility to it whatsoever. Great waste of time. Very extravagant. Wasting time is extravagant. We don't realize that we're super extravagant. This whole thing is just an extravaganza. Existence is it's a totally unnecessary, totally whimsical extravaganza of ridiculous. So all we're doing on spiritual path, you become practical, just practical. You stop being so extravagant. I mean, you just say, hey, you know, I just need the perfect antidepressant. That's all I need. I don't need anything else. And all that needs to be is useful. Because the only usefulness that hypotheticals have, the only usefulness they will ever have is to remind us of reality. That's it. Nothing more. And if something reminds us of reality, it's totally useful, right? It's practically useful. And then we use it for that, and then discard it. Once its usefulness is over, we simply set it down. That's it. We don't need to make anything out of it. We don't need to make anything out of the spiritual path at all. We just need to do it. That's all. We just need to do it. And the problem is, again, overlearning. It steps gets on our way. So we engage in all this extravaganza, trying to find rituals and hair and paint and... all this stuff is trying to find a way to get past this overlearning problem. And so everyone has their own way of trying to do it, of course. But what happens is people seem to can take the ends for the means for the end. The means for the end, and that's a big mistake. As you proceed on the path, you become more and more sober and less and less inclined to those type of extravagances and you say, forget it. No, not necessary. So I look at the Purnakum Mela in Allahabad, or was it Prayag? Do I want to go there? No. I don't want to go there. Are you kidding? What a waste of time for me. I have a friend that's there who's going to, I'm sure he's going to take a lot of video. I'm going to watch it. Maybe I'll edit the video for you so you can watch and see. I find it very helpful to look at spiritual stuff, the religious stuff, whatever goes on in the world, and just say, wait a minute, is that really necessary? Is that the best use of time? Is that truly practical? Or is that extravagant? Is that the best use of time, really? So, I don't know. And then you can listen here to this channel, Clary Ross, and say, maybe this is a better use of time. Maybe we're getting to it more quickly, more directly. And you can feel, it's like, is it boom, 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 boom? I mean, if you're not getting anything profound from these videos, you shouldn't even be watching. And of course, I repeat over and over, because that overlearning is the only key. You got it. There's no way around it. There's no way around it. So I keep repeating, of course. But it should be profound. Everything should be something's profound. You should feel something's really profound that struck you. Say, wow, that's profound. Otherwise, you're wasting your time. And if I weren't saying anything profound, I wouldn't be doing that. I'm wasting my time. So, of course, I have some things to say that I know are very profound. And again, the only difference between me and anybody else is temporarily, because of my work ethic, I'm a little more clear than others. I have a little clearer view of salvation. I'm more aware and more focused and see it better than most. But that's only temporary, because ultimately everybody will see it completely clearly and will take the perfect antidepressant and will never be depressed ever again. Oh, everyone will. Nobody ever even left reality. We're all one. We're all the same. Nobody's special. Nobody's higher. Nobody's lower. So when you're listening to someone like myself say, well, yeah, I do know the truth. I do know the way of salvation. I do know this stuff. The stuff that I'm saying, I do know it. I know it's true. But so all you're doing is intelligent deference. You're saying, okay, I'm hearing something profound, so I'm going to defer, meaning you're not going to argue. You're going to spend your time listening to it, and you're not going to argue. You're not going to get into argumentative state of mind. If an argumentative state of mind comes up, you say, that's a thought form. That's not me. I'm deferring intelligently here. I don't want that thought form. Forget it. Something extravagant is trying to enter into me and waste my time. You say, forget it. I'm just listening. I'm just having an... But it's temporary deference, because you will also be just as clear and more so, just like I will be more so. We'll all be eventually perfectly clear about it all, and we'll make the exchange of hypothetical of not needing any hypotheticals. We will see the beautiful vision, the vision of beauty, exquisite beauty, vision of forgiveness, vision of perfect forgiveness. We will all see that. We will all see the total non-necessity of trying to make death real, and then ultimately we'll set down hypotheticals altogether. Every single one will do that. So there's impossible for someone to say that they're permanently greater than someone else, which is what Daffrey John did, which is why he was a fake. He was a phony. He was a plant of the reptilians. And very unfortunate thing. It caused a lot of problems here. Did a lot of undermining. There's no way, it's completely impossible for any one of us to be greater than any of us. The greatest in heaven is exactly the same as the least in heaven. It's all one. There's no rank in reality at all. None. Never can never be. The only thing in reality that is greater than us is the Prime Creator, because the Prime Creator created us. We didn't create the Prime Creator, but the Prime Creator created us the same as the Prime Creator, except we didn't do our own creation. So the Prime Creator is primary. Okay, that's the only, and creation goes in one direction. But there is no hierarchy in reality. There are no levels in reality. There's no specialness in reality. There wasn't some aspect of the sonship that was created greater or better or special. That's total insanity. It's total egoic insanity, which is trying to make death real. That's all that it is. And God does not incarnate in the world, does not incarnate in the flesh. God can't become flesh. That's saying the reality can become hypothetical. That's impossible. Or it's saying that the hypothetical can become real, which is totally impossible. No, absolutely not. The Prime Creator simply blessed reality, blessed hypotheticals with what's called the vision of Christ. There's a blessing, the Holy Spirit, a reinterpretation of the staging that we made. It's simply a blessing upon the staging that we have made. All this hypothetical staging where we're trying to make death real, there's a blessing upon it, which enables us to look upon it and remember what reality is. That's all the Prime Creator did. That's it. So the idea that Daffrey John was God here, incarnate on the planet, and then saying the only thing you can do on the spiritual path is worship me, because you'll always be lesser than me. You'll always be less. There's no way that anyone can be as great as me. Total nonsense. Total insanity. But up till that point, he hadn't really crossed over the line. What happened was he crossed over the line, and it seemed like then the whole spiritual confidence, it must be insanity or arrogance. It's not. Spiritual confidence is super important here. It's super important for those who know the truth to say they know the truth. All important. But, of course, if they cross over the line, the Holy Spirit will tell you. Because I was warned that this guy was dangerous. In fact, he was driving people into suicide. What I was shown was he's part of the suicidal plan of the planet. That he was setting this planet up for mass suicide. That's what the Holy Spirit showed me and told me. He said, and stay away. And I did. I was examining him. I said, what is this guy? What's he here for? I was like, hey, what in the world is this guy here for? He's very powerful, psychically powerful, very psychically powerful, actually. He had a force field around him. And the subtle levels, I went to see him on the subtle psychic levels and then subtler levels, and boom, I tried to walk up to him, and I was, bam, like I hit a barrier. He had this force field around him. Very strong force field. But he was very intimidating on the psychic levels. Incredibly intimidating. Very forceful. And very psychic. He had a very intense psychic field around him. So, if somebody crosses over the line, the Holy Spirit will tell you. Okay? So if I cross over the line, the Holy Spirit will tell you. And you say, forget it. Forget about this guy. And I'm not going to pay any more attention. If I cross over the line, you see. But crossing over the line means that you say that you're above everyone else permanently, which is, you know, I've explicitly said hundreds of times, absolutely not, that's impossible. Absolutely impossible. So, I have a long track record of very explicitly saying where I stand on that issue of, is such a thing possible? And absolutely not possible. I reject Daffrey John, Adida, Samraj, whatever he wants to call himself. He can call himself all these grandiose names he wants. I reject the whole entire notion of it, and say it was setting up the planet for suicide for this random acts of savagery. Really, making us vulnerable, very vulnerable, to the psychic attack. Because he's saying, like, the only shield you really have is me. That's what he's really saying, telling everybody. He says, I'm your only shield. He's trying to get the whole world to say, accept him as the only true shield there could possibly be, as God. And then, of course, when people trust him to be the shield, then he will just suddenly drop his shield, not shield anybody at all, leave them completely vulnerable. It's like a wolf in sheep's clothing. So I said, no. I'm going to put my faith in Jesus. As expressed in A Course in Miracles, not as expressed in the Bible, because that was a clever ruse to postpone the reptilians from coming here, and its usefulness had worn out. So, it's hard to judge why that was necessary, but I can see the rationale for it. It's possible that we were so ignorant and so vulnerable that we needed to buy some time, and that worked. But at this time, you need real shielding. because the reptilians have seen through that ruse. They've been able to penetrate it. They've been able to wear it down. They planted priests in the Catholic Church, for instance, and then put thought forms into these priests' minds. Something that weakened them. Some weak men had them become priests. They directed thought forms, psychic thought forms, to their minds. These priests accept them as if they was coming from God, thinking they're under God's orders, and they hear this thought. They're aware of this thought in their mind, and then they think that they need to act upon these thoughts. So there's all this terrible molestation problem in the church from these molds. Excuse me. They're psychic molds that went in there, and therefore then they tried to pull the whole church down and get people to disbelieve in that shielding trick kind of Jesus's that crucifixion situation. And so people, what happened was globally, people no longer have really, reverence for the church. Saying a mouthful here. And that just opened the floodgates. The pulling away of reverence from religion opened the floodgates. But the floodgates have already been opened. So, there's no reason to close the barn door after the animals are already out. So that's why I'm speaking now openly about this. I didn't before. Because I understood the church had very positive function here. It's just that it wasn't the fullness of the gospel. Was not. At some point, you got to realize that was just a device that was used. But the truth is way beyond that. It's something different entirely. We have to switch hypotheticals. It's actually way more practical. You can't make death real and then overcome it. That's utter nonsense. So, the floodgates are open. Have to be shielded. And maybe it's becoming tough to talk now because what I'm saying is so direct and so intense that it's not easy to say. Maybe I'm getting some psychic backlash, actually. Maybe there's some psychic platform trying to interfere with my voice right now, actually. That's sort of how maybe that bug was an attempt to interfere with my voice. Maybe they're trying to give me the flu bug or something, as it were, and keep me from speaking. Because what I'm saying, they don't like at all. Why? Because I'm saying you don't have to make death real. You can't make death real, so there's no point in even engaging in that exercise. And for them, they feel it's all important, that their salvation depends on making death real. So they think everybody's got to get into this folly and become savage towards one another. Now, this whole gun thing is a double-edged sword, isn't it? Because you think if people have guns, they're going to become much more savage to one another, right? Not true. Actually, it's not true. People will actually be less savage. Because they say, wait a minute, I better, it's too dangerous to be savage to my neighbor because my neighbor's got same artillery I do. So let's be very kind to one another. Let's not engage in any savagery here. But when savagery can become severe is when people don't have guns and they're vulnerable. And then you get a crazy shooter just come into a place people are helpless and defenseless. That's what the reptilians are more after. But once the civilization has deteriorated to significant extent, then maybe they'll be passing out guns to everybody. Say, hey, everybody, just shoot everybody up. Let's just do what the, but right now they want guns to be only in the hands of criminals who are weak people who are under their control. Most criminals are under the control of the reptilians, the psychic platforms. They're being used. They're weak-minded, very weak-minded. And they usually have a control that is working to undermine them. Which we get into the male-female thing and all that kind of stuff, how that works, which is very, very cleverly done also, actually. Most of the people who do the dirty work are the men. They do the butchery. But there's always, almost always, there's a woman involved, too. and she is a, like a psychic. The women tend to be more psychic, and they are able to sort of amplify and make sure that the man is getting the psychic thought forms, making sure that they are taking them personally. They think that they're something personal. And they make sure that that takes place. And so then the man then does the dirty work. And the woman says, I'm shocked. How could you possibly do such a thing? My gosh, I didn't even know him. I didn't know anything about this. You know, the infinite, innocent ingenue, you know, thing. Oh, of course. No, they're absolutely complicit. 100%. Accomplices. Total accomplices. They're psychic accomplices. They work more at the psychic level. Subtler levels. Making sure that the thought form takes, you know, the injection of that thought form takes and gets hold, and make sure the man gets more and more weak-minded, more and more can't distinguish between his own thoughts and the thoughts of the psychic thought forms of violence, etc., criminality. And then finally, a situation gets set up where then they act on these thought forms. And almost always, the French have the saying, cherchez la femme, means you can't solve a crime, make sure that you accounted for the role of the woman in the crime, because inevitably, behind the scenes, there is that other level of feminine involvement in all this. Absolutely. And we think that all men are just these terrible butchers. No. If we didn't accept these thought forms and didn't get worn down culturally, we wouldn't do this. We don't want to butcher anybody. That's nonsense. It doesn't arise from our thoughts. We were able to distinguish between, say, wait a minute, this isn't the path of salvation. We say, well, this, let's stop this. We don't really want to do it. But it's easy. Well, we can get confused. Men can get confused if they get worked on enough. They absolutely can. If they get weakened enough, if they get enough constant reinforcement, you got to control there, constantly saying, are you getting that thought? Are you getting it? They're monitoring. Very clever monitors, really. And a lot of men and women know exactly what I'm talking about. And so that's how it goes in this world. And this is why the world needs to be shielded from this. And we're working towards that. Awareness is working towards it, but we have to overlearn this awareness. We have to overlearn it. There's a lot of destabilized people out there. I've been barking about this for so long. I said, my God, if we don't stop it now, we're going to have a world full of destabilized people, because there's an effort to destabilize as many people as possible. And we now have that. Just look at all the terrorists, look at all the, that whole thing too, very destabilized, right? Incredibly so. They're willing to walk into a marketplace and just obliterate everybody there. Of course they're being controlled by thought forms. Absolutely. Of course they're being told this will get them into heaven. Of course. So that's all mind control. It's psychic thought forms and using mind control, etc. Very bad. Whereas we're just expecting random acts of savagery in this world now. It's absolutely nuts. So we can't be shielded from that. We will be shielded from it. We do have to overlearn the whole situation, which is why we need to keep going over it. Don't think that you're stupid if you're overlearning. I mean, I'm sure that if people looked at my path, they'd say, boy, you're kind of stupid, aren't you? You've been studying this book for 35 years. What's the matter with you? I said, I understood it the first time I read it, but I've been overlearning it for 35 years. Because that's what it takes. Overlearning is the answer. So the brightest students don't seem to be the brightest students at all. Just the opposite. They seem to be the dumb ones. They say, well, why are you still reading that book? We moved on already from that. Oh, we moved on. I said, No. I need to reread this again. How many times have you gone over that? Hundreds, maybe thousands of times. They say, wow, are you retarded? So there is that pressure, on you that they think you must be retarded. How come you can't get it? But I was smart enough that I was able to reject that pressure to a certain extent, but I really didn't tell anyone what I was doing, because I was scared that people would think I was retarded, because why am I spending all this time reading a book? Didn't I understand it the first time? The same thing. necessity to overlearn. So the smartest people in the world are the ones that are reading, studying truth, and going over and over and over and over truth, because they realize the principle of overlearning is necessary. Those are the truly bright ones. And so they may seem to be the slow ones, the tortoises. They're tortoises every day. The hare's looking at the tortoise saying, "Come, tortoise, you are the slowest. You're so slow, it's unbelievable. Didn't you just take that step? I mean, just it seems like you're taking the same steps over and over. You're not even jumping anywhere. What's the matter with you?" Now, the tortoise is just going over and over and over and over and over this similar material from every angle, just overlearning it over and over and over and over again. And then one day, the tortoise just walks across the finish line and says, "This is just a very practical thing to do. Totally practical, purely practical. Just because it's useful." And then sees a vision of Christ. "Oh, this is useful. I say this is useful. I can get used to this. Very, you know, what I need to do? I just need to get used to it. I need to overlearn this." So I just keep overlearning. I say, "Okay, I just need to overlearn this." Just that very practical attitude. When enlightenment comes, the student has been properly prepared, but just simply look at it and say, "Okay, let me start overlearning this now. I'm just going to overlearn this." And just say, they won't drop it. They'll say, "No, if I drop it, how can I overlearn it? I've got to keep holding it, so I keep looking at it." Whereas the hare will look at it and say, "Oh, that was cool. That was great. Oh, that was really neat. Wow, that's fabulous. Had a high, had a peak moment. Okay, I got it. Now what's next?" Now, see, then the hare just goes to sleep. Starts trying to make death real again. The tortoise is saying, I need to hold on to this because I need to overlearn it. And the tortoise knows, "Oh, this is very useful, very practical, and I know I have to overlearn it, so I'm going to hold on to it. I'm just going to get very, very familiar with it and overlearn it." Then you have what's called a steady, steady, steady enlightenment. And then that's very helpful to the world. But what I'm leading you to is so you don't feel like you need to jump up and shout hallelujah and run down the streets and everything. Now forget that. That's not useful. "Hey, everybody, I just saw truth." We see truth every day, really. Or, "I just got a glimpse of the vision of Christ. I saw it, I saw it, I saw it, I saw it." Now the tortoise will say, "Okay, this looks very practical, very useful. It looks perfectly useful, purely practical. Okay, what do I do? Okay, I need to overlearn this. Okay, so I need to stay there. That's also very perfectly practical. I must stay there. So I got to just keep my attention on it. I'm just going to overlearn it. Calm, calm, calm. Blissful. Also, but calm and focused on it. That's it." So you might see those who act. Some are actually probably in the world that are enlightened, and people don't even know it, hardly, because they're just overlearning it. They're just sitting there. They'll just sit there quietly. And you think, "Oh, they must not be seeing anything that great. Else they'd be doing cartwheels." No. They seriously perfection, to see exquisite beauty, but they know they have to overlearn it. They just keep looking at it. And he's like Ramana Maharshi, he's just looking at it. He's just abiding. He said, "You got to abide in it. That's a great advice. You need to abide in it." It means overlearn it. Overlearn it. Practical. Totally practical, right? Because once you've overlearned that, then you can set all hypotheticals down, because this is like a reflection of reality. You say, "Wow, this is very similar to reality." Because why? You don't want to change a thing. You don't want to change anything. Nothing needs to be changed. And it's exquisitely beautiful. And you're just allowing everything to be as it is. And it's perfectly acceptable to you. That mirrors reality, where everything is perfectly acceptable to you. And you don't want to change a thing. You just want to expand the love. Add to it, as it were. But you don't want to change the love. You don't want to change anything about reality. You just want to add more, keep expanding that. That's all. But you love everything that's already there. You wouldn't change a thing. Absolutely not. So you need to get something that simulates that, and hypothetical can only simulate reality, can only reflect it, as it were. Give it hypothetical. And you need to overlearn that too. You need to overlearn that too. So you don't. It's not like the path ends when you're enlightened. You still need to overlearn the vision of Christ. You still have to overlearn that. But if you're in the habit of overlearning, then of course you can step into that and just say, "Okay, I just overlearned this. No problem." So really the very best habit you can get is the habit of overlearning. And how do you do that? By working every day at it. That's the only way. You can't overlearn by I'll do a seminar this weekend, and then next year I'll have another seminar this weekend at the same time, or have a retreat, and then in 4 years I'll have another retreat, or next year I'll go on the same retreat. That's not overlearning. That's trying to get a peak experience. Very different. Very different. What I see in the world is too much emphasis on peak experiences, and not nearly enough emphasis on overlearning. And that whole thing, it used to be emphasis on overlearning was all important. And it's really changed as society gets undermined. Now we're all about peak experiences. We're all about drugs. Let's take a drug. Let's get a high. Let's get a quick high. Let's get a peak experience. So, of course, you can run all these seminars and people go, and you can structure them in such a way that you're going to be able to manufacture some peak experiences for people. But, you know, if overlearning isn't at the root of it, at the heart of the whole situation, it really might do more harm than good. Because someone will say, hey, that's easy, I can do it anytime I want to. I'll do it next year at the retreat. And then that's it. Then they go out and say, hey, this life's not so bad. You know, I feel pretty good here. I had a peak experience, everybody, yeah. And they can live off that peak experience for the rest of the year, or for years maybe. Some people live off the peak experience their whole lives, telling other people about their peak experience. Really, that is very true. There's some that have several peak experiences, and they spend the whole, make a career out of telling people about their particular peak experience. But hopefully the flavor you get here is very different. Is what here I just go over and over and over and over and over the basics. Overlearning, exchange hypothetical scenarios, etc. Sure, I've had peak experiences, but those are not nearly as important. Just put them on the back burner, whatever. It boils down to having this habit of overlearning, because even when you take the perfect antidepressant, you still need to overlearn that too. You can go around telling people about that, but the emphasis has to be on overlearning still. You can be enlightened, but you have to keep telling people, hey, look, you need to sweat the overlearning part of it. You got to do it. There's no way around it. No way around it. People had asked Anonymous, Mao, tell us about your peak experiences. She says, there's really nothing to say. Yogananda asked her about that, probably in Ranchi. And Ranchi, India, and she said, Father, there's really very little to say. Very little. She said, before I came into this world, I was the same. As I entered into this world, I was the same. As I'm here in the world, I am the same. And when I depart from this world, I shall be the same. And even as the dance of eternity, dance of existence, dances in the halls of eternity, he says, I shall ever, forever be the same. That's it. She said, there's really nothing to say. So that's about all she had to say about herself. No peak experiences. And then she'd say, hey, everybody, you need to overlearn. You want to boil all her teaching down in a nutshell, it's just simply, you need to overlearn. That's it. Get to it. That's all. You think the guru is someone who's going to talk about their peak experiences? Forget it. The real gurus are the ones that tell you, get to work on overlearning. That's it. Because that's what's really useful. And they know that you're in harm's way as far as the existence is trying to make death real. And as such, you are really going to be put through the meat grinder, both figuratively and literally. I mean, there's savages, the savagery on this planet that has been inculcated in the people through many cultural means, very dark stuff, super, super violent video games, super death metal, thrash metal, you know, some of this music, you know, vocal rasping, just all this music is so demonic, so satanic, so oriented trying to make death real. People have been mainlining that for so long, mainlining super violent games, super violent images, all this stuff. Their aim is savagery, is putting you through meat grinders. You know, it's just they live to invent more barbaric forms of death and torture. Really, their dreams are how can we kill somebody, you know, more intensely. That's what they dream about. And the world is saturated with people like that right now, and who are very vulnerable to thought forms to act this kind of stuff out when the blitzkrieg comes, and it started. what you're going to see is this going to start being acted out now? These people are like Manchurian candidates. They've been primed to act out this butchery. They've been dreaming and trying to come up with what can we do? This is like truly horrific. And then when they get these thought forms that tell them that they need to do this, they'll think, oh, that's me, that's what I want to do, and then they'll act on it. So, of course, these teachers know this. And so that's why they tell you, look, get to work overlearning. That's what Jesus told me, get to work overlearning. Come on, don't stop. I said, Jesus, I got it. He said, no. Learn, get it again. I said, well, I understand. He said, understand again. I said, what's wrong with you? You don't believe me? He says, no, I know you're really capable, but show me again. Do it again. And that's why I said, I got to show you again. I'll read it again. Now I understand. This is my understanding. He says, okay, let's hear it again. Again. Give me understanding again. So I just keep working on it nonstop like that. And today, same thing. Just work on it just like I did 35 years ago. Same work ethic. Just overlearning. That's what the great teachers tell you. That's what they're here for. Motivate you to overlearn. So just keep that as your mantra. Motivation to overlearn. Who gives me, where do I get that motivation to overlearn? And then get that. That's the real teaching. That is the real teaching. If you want the real teaching, it's the motivation to overlearn. Of course, overlearn truth. God's plan of salvation, switching hypotheticals, exchange belief systems, as Jesus puts it. Vision of Christ, vision of Krishna, the overlay, the blessed world, the blessed vision, spiritual vision. There's lots of terminologies you can use. The grace of God. Lots of terminology been used, but there is this. It's really switching hypotheticals is what it really is. What if we didn't need hypotheticals? That's still a hypothetical. If we didn't need any hypotheticals, we wouldn't need to try to make hypotheticals real, would we? Which means we could allow everything that appears to us be translated into perfect beauty, exquisite beauty, because we wouldn't have no other use for it. So the blessing that God gives us, the Holy Spirit, it needs our acceptance, our allowance to bless the world. And we won't give it until we exchange hypotheticals and say, okay, I've chosen the hypothetical of not needing any hypotheticals. They're totally unnecessary. And then at that point, the blessing of the Holy Spirit retranslate, all the staging will appear to be exquisitely, seamlessly beautiful to us. And we'll say, okay, I don't need the hypotheticals, to no necessity for them to be anything at all, but this is useful because it reminds me of reality. So it's very, very useful. It's very helpful. That's it. Very practical. You just have that. Very practical. Perfectly practical. And again, we're overlearning here, of course. That's why these videos are long, which is why I go over stuff over and over. It's overlearning. You say, I got that the first time. Did you get it the second time? Did you get it the third time? Did you get it the fourth time? The fifth time? And then you say, yeah, I even got it the fifth time. So, okay, good. Yeah, and what about the sixth? So don't slacken your efforts. That's what Sri Anandamayi, she'd say to people, she'd say, look, you got to go faster. And you must not slacken your efforts. You must continue efforts daily. Don't let a day go by where you don't increase your pace. Same thing with Jesus. Just the same kind of message. They don't say, hey, let me tell you about that time, you know, when I went to Varanasi, Kashi, as they, and I'm on the ghats, bathing ghats, and the heavens opened up, and there's light flooded down. And let me tell you, no. Because they're looking at perfect beauty constantly. What do they need to tell you about their peak experiences for? Now, they might do that for some that kind of need that song and dance, whatever, but then they say, hey, now you got the story, now you need to go to work. What about your effort? What about your overlearning? How many times have you overlearned today? How many hours have you spent overlearning today? For me today, how many hours have I spent? Started when I woke up early this morning. It started right then. And it's been going constantly all day. So, how many hours has it been? What time is it now? Already today it's been more than 12 hours, let's put it that way, of working on overlearning. And we'll continue in the evening, no doubt. Maybe I'll try to make some videos for you. You know, if you understand what I'm doing it for, is to contrast the pomp and circumstance. Maybe I'll put them on another channel. the big boost or something, if you like. But it's helpful. It's super helpful, because if you look at the super glamorous spiritual stuff, you can say, "Do I want that?" It's kind of cool. And after a while, you think about it and say, you know what? It really doesn't seem to have that much pull. You know, it doesn't. It seems to be kind of extravagant, waste of time. I can't afford to waste time. And then you get back to overlearning. See, a lot of people on the path of overlearning, they burn out. And overlearning is the only path there is. You burn out. You say, "Oh God, again." I wake up in the morning and say, "You gotta be kidding me. I gotta go through overlearn again. I've gone through this stuff hundreds of thousands of times. I gotta go through it again. You know, 1,000 times today. Good Lord, another 1,000 times. Oh my gosh." And it's not like Japa. These Japa, yeah, that's pretty mechanistic, really, pretty mechanical. No, the overlearning I do is inspirational and artful, and always in transposed into a fresh format. You know, it always has slightly different variations, which I'm able to do because I in previous life, I don't know how many lives previous, but I was a musician and a composer, and my whole thing was reworking themes, change variations on a theme. You know, I was very talented at that, super workaholic on that. Talented because I was a workaholic, really. Because you're not gonna be talented really unless you really apply yourself. Most there's a few savants, you know, that are just born. It just seems easy, but that's because they've done in a previous life. So I would continuously rework themes, but you know, just subtle changes, and overlearn it. So, continued in this life, I just was able to keep just overlearn it. But now the overlearning is not music; it's God's plan of salvation. But the principle of overlearning is very similar. And what I do is I just slight variations. I'm not trying to repeat like a parrot. You can train a parrot to squawk all day, and you know, some kind of mantra all day. Da 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 da. The parrot will say something. You know, "God is great," or something. It'll say, "God is great." The parrot, 10,000 times a day, the parrot will say that. Doesn't mean anything, really. Parrot's not learning anything. So you need to, overlearning has to be contextually rich. It has to be meaningful to you. You have to see it. You have to say, "Let me see it this way. Let me see it again. Let me put a slightly different light on it. And you just, you keep working on it and say, "Let me expand this. Let me generalize. Let me see it more clearly." And so it seems ever fresh, kind of. There's an ever freshness to the path that I've been on overlearning. It always seems fresh. I say, "Yeah, it's the same song, but I'm singing it slightly differently." So I can sing a song. I have sung some songs thousands of times. But it's always different. I sing it differently every time. And I used to practice that a lot, singing. I'd sing the same song over and over and over and over and over, and every single time I'd make it different. But it's the same song. And people say, "Oh, that's the same song." But there's all these subtle nuances and changes I'd make. It's just, I'd play the pacing, and whether you're on top of the word or behind the words, or you're hitting the middle of the words, or you're popping the beginning, where's the emphasis? You know, are you smoothing out the ending? Or are you smoothing into the beginning of all the phrasing? All this kind of stuff, I just like would be able to just play with it endlessly, making variations on a phrase or something. And just you find out you can just really go on just almost forever on coming up with different variations and emoting it and how you go about singing a song. You can do it differently every time. And so I just practice that over and over and over. Spiritual path is just like that, except you're practicing truth over and over and over, reminding yourself, "You know, I've got to exchange hypotheticals." Now, what does that mean? I've got to, you know, I need the happy hypothetical. Those, like, that's my own words, happy hypothetical. You come up with your own phrases, your own words. If you're able to do that, then, you know, that means you are really in the groove. If you're able to transpose what's being said into your own words and make it meaningful for you, and then overlearn it over and over and over and keep it fresh for yourself, then you are being very successful, actually. And the only thing I would say, I know there's some viewers here that are very, very much on the spiritual path, and they say, well, how come I'm not finishing? Because of the overlearning problem. How come I'm not finishing? If anyone should be finished, it should be me. I've been overlearning like crazy for so long. But it's the overlearning problem. So you can get it. You can see it. You say, I see it. I see it. I see it all. But then the overlearning, boy, kind of something within you says, yeah, but it's not real yet. It's not real yet. You got to wait until it gets real. It's not quite real yet. You say, oh my gosh. And it takes the wind out of your sails. It really does. It's possible for someone to take the leap and just say, forget about the overlearning. I've had it. That's it. But I've never been able to take that leap. Very few have. The overlearning problem is a gigantic problem. It's the worst problem we have, really. We have the continuity problem and the overlearning problem. But the overlearning problem is practically what prevents us from getting the cure for the continuity problem. The blessed world is the cure for the continuity problem. And yet we refuse to accept the blessed world because we're waiting for it to become real, to be useful, rather, waiting for it to become purely practical and useful to us, because we think it must not be because we haven't overlearned it yet enough. And so that's the practical problem we have. So all I can say is you have to keep doing it. Some musicians actually are very good on the spiritual path. They tend to be drawn to it because they're used to this overlearning thing of creativity, creatively making it interesting, the music, you know, always adding a twist, you know, to it, adding something. Say, it's the same song, but I'm hearing it even better. Let's do it this way. It's even better. It's even clearer. Gosh, I mean, like if I'm writing a song or putting the music or something, theoretically I could spend years and years and years on one song. And making it better and better and better and better and better and better and better. But why waste all that time on a song when you can be using it on the spiritual path, which is what I finally learned. I said, wow, it's a waste of time. Why should I be spending my talents on trying to help the ego out, beautifying the world, so that we don't change hypotheticals, so the ego can say, ah, what's this world? What's wrong with this world? You got all this beautiful music. Why don't you listen to this song? Look how great this song. And I could craft exquisite songs like a Fabergé egg, you know, like a Tiffany jewel or whatever. I could make these exquisite songs that I'd slave over, perfecting every little tiny little thing in the past. And but that's only for the ego. The ego then uses that to deceive us. What we need to overlearn is spiritual truth, really. That, and so I gradually gravitated into that, and I became less and less. I became kind of careless about music. I said, let me just knock out this song real quickly and not worry about making it perfect. One take, you know, just do it one take. That's for, do everything one boom, 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 boom. Quick, let's do it quick. We need it right now. Quick, forget it about spending all this time. I got other stuff I got to do, so I got to do it right. You know, just do it real fast. And so my music then deteriorated, which is okay because I used the extra time to overlearn spiritual truths. Which is why I'm able to speak now and help others overlearn them too. The teachers, the effective ones, help you overlearn. That's what they're doing. They're not trying to give you some high. I'm not trying to give you some high. I'm not trying to give you some Shakti pot. I'm not trying to give you a peak experience here. Not really. No. If it happens, it happens. That's not the point. The point is overlearning. Because only by overlearning are you going to see. It's just like, ho-hum, okay, I can accept enlightenment, and I'm just going to overlearn that too, and just another day in the life, no big deal, just I see it, this is super, perfectly useful, perfectly practical. I know this is going to help enable me to drop all hypotheticals, but the overlearning is more important, so I'm just going to keep overlearning it. When you get to that stage, when you get to that blasé stage, business as usual stage, then you can just accept enlightenment like that. It's just another day in the life. That's the real day in the life that you're preparing for. But if you freak out, you say, oh my God, it is so incredible. I felt I loved everybody. Oh my God, I want to tell all my friends. I want to hug everybody. It's so amazing. And then you spend the rest of your life telling everybody about how amazing it was. Nah, you, you haven't got it at all. You need to get on the spiritual path. That's the beginning of the spiritual path. I mean, the spiritual path began for me when I woke up. I awakened. I was enlightened. I saw it. I saw exactly the truth of the whole situation. And then I started sinking back down because someone said, well, it's not real yet. That's, you know. And I said, I realized I had this overlearning problem. I said, there's no way around it. You just got to start, go to work. I said, I knew if I went to work, then I'd return to this enlightened condition permanently. Because I'd continue to overlearn it, and just stick right with it. It'd stay with me. So that'll come. It'll come for sure. At some point, I don't know when. How can you know when the overlearning comes to an end? How can you know when you have enough overlearning that you finally say, to heck with this, I don't know. It's hard to say. It's really hard to say for anybody. So don't worry if you don't have peak experiences. I mean, from that point was 35 years ago. I've never had a peak experience like that since. Never. I've had other peak experiences which were amazing for sure, but it wasn't the full light awakening. It wasn't actually knowing that you have awoken from the dream. I woke from the dream 1978. 35 years ago I woke from the dream. And what have I been doing since? Overlearning truth. Knowing what the path really is, how it all works, overlearning all of that stuff. So this awakening state will be permanently with me because I'll be overlearning it. I'll be insisting, no, don't go away. I haven't learned yet. You learned enough. I haven't overlearned you enough yet. I got to overlearn you more. You can't go away. You got to stay with me. Every day, every minute. I'm not gonna let go of you. I'm not gonna set you down. Then you have someone who's really helpful in the world. You know, really super helpful, because then they're just going to show you this is the goal, this is what's here for you, and you have to overlearn to get there. That's where you get it, Jesus, Anandamaya Mahabrahmana Maharshi. You get those types who have it constantly with them, and in their cases it's effortless because they've probably set down hypotheticals, and they're only picking up hypotheticals for our sake. Again, they've already set hypotheticals down. Case of Anandamaya Maharshi never picked up hypotheticals at all. And maybe in Jesus, I don't know, maybe that's the same thing. Never picked up any hypotheticals. Or maybe he did, I don't know. Or maybe he picked them up just to see what it was like to go through it for us to show, you know, it's possible, those things. But in any case, they show us what it's like, how wonderful, how blissful it is, how serene, how calm, how untroubled, how unthreatening it is. And then they teach us to overlearn. They tell us, what are you doing today? How are your efforts today? Are you increasing your efforts? Have you done more today than you did yesterday? Have you pushed yourself the utmost today? Every day? That's it. There is no other spiritual path. Overlearning is the spiritual path. So if you're doing that, here's the flip side. If you are every day overlearning, and you said, my gosh, I just gone over this for the thousandth time. So many times I've gone over this. If you are doing that, and you know who you are, then you can be sure you're really, really hardcore on the spiritual path, which means you're really, really going to succeed. For sure, you're going to succeed. That is the secret to success. So when you know that, you try even harder to overlearn, keep overlearning even more. So you can know for sure. You can know for sure if you're on the spiritual path. There's no secret at all. If you really are overlearning, then you're on it. You're on the real path. There's lots of other stuff that's not. It's going after peak experiences. That's not the real path. It's not. Those are people who are just trying, like stretching before the marathon starts. You got this big marathon. There's all these people at the start line, and they're all going through their calisthenics and stretching and breathing and hydrating, and they're doing all this stuff. I'm really psyching themselves up. Guys are getting all psyched up, you know, these people. And they're getting ready. I'm going to run a marathon here. Wow. Woo. All this stuff. And you look and you see some people running, you know, running, and say, look at the clock, and you say, wait a minute. What's going on? You say, people, hey, people. It seems like the race has already started. What's going on? I say, no. We're preparing. Or yeah, we're running. We're in the marathon. Sure. So what are you talking about? You haven't even gone across the start line yet. And yeah, I talk to these people and say, oh, yeah, we finished the marathon. We already finished. Or we're far along the marathon. Sure. I said, folks, you're just doing calisthenics. You're just stretching. You haven't even started yet. You haven't even started. So if you're chasing peak experiences, you haven't started the marathon, really. You haven't even started the spiritual path. When you get a peak experience like I did, then you realize, what I realized, I very clearly realized the only things preventing me from experiencing this every moment was that is this overlearning problem. I have to just get to work, and that's it. That's all I realized. That's all I saw. I said, it's just a matter of work. From this point on, you simply have to work at it every day. That's it. That's it. So that's all I've done. Well, not really chasing after any peak experience, which is why I don't really go to gurus or waste time doing that. I say, hey, I'm busy here overlearning the situation. Why do I need to go see this guru and get a contact high? I already woke up. I already know what awakening is. I already experienced that. I experienced the bliss. I experienced the amrita, the nectar of immortality, the bliss, whatever you want to call it, the rasa. I experienced the clarity. I experienced whatever you want to call it, the realization that you're flawless, you're perfect, you never left reality. I already experienced all of it. So why do I need to go to get a contact high? What good is that going to do me? Because I have to overlearn all this stuff. I got to overlearn how it really works, so I can have it permanently. I got to know all this stuff, all this important information about why did this self-deception arise in the first place. What are we doing here? What is this hypothetical scenario for? Why are we so enmeshed in it? Why all this stuff? And what is this remedy really for? So then when I get the remedy, I realize how totally practical it is, and why it is the remedy, and then that I need to overlearn it. And then you have all that there. But when you get the first peak experience, you don't know all that stuff. You just know that you had a sudden breakthrough. And of course, there are a lot of people out there selling these breakthroughs. You know, come to this retreat and you will have, a breakthrough. Well, yeah, probably. For a lot of people, they do have a breakthrough of some sort. Maybe not the big one. I mean, really seeing it, really, truly awakening. Because when you awaken, I knew perfectly for a fact that I had awakened from delusion entirely. No question about it. And then also, I was perfectly aware that I was sinking back into it. No doubt about that either. And I knew that it was going to take quite some time, quite a bit of work to get back there. I knew that too. That was it. I said, what a bummer. What a bummer, I said, well, hey, it's so great, it's worth working towards. So you can tell the ones who've had the real breakthrough is that they're just working like crazy and overlearning. Whereas the ones that have kind of faux breakthroughs, they're going around telling everybody about their peak experience. I never told anybody about my peak experience. Forget it. So I'm too busy working on overlearning what I need to overlearn. Why talk about it? I know the way to get back is to do this work. So talking about it is a waste of time. It's a waste of time. It's slowing me down. I don't want to talk about it. In fact, some of the people most successful on the spiritual path, those you don't even know are on the spiritual path. Nobody has a clue. I never told anybody. Never told anybody I was studying A Course in Miracles. Never told anybody what I was doing. Forget it. Waste of time. And those are go spend their time telling everybody about their peak experience back in such and such. Why go see them? Why go see them? Because you hope you're going to get a peak experience. Well, if you've already had one, then the only thing you need to do is work at overlearning. Why waste the time? Why waste the time, Why bother? Why bother? I already knew. I already knew that what it's like, and I already knew that there's a problem to get back to that. There's a problem that we're enmeshed in this situation of. I didn't call it overlearning at the time, but now I realize that's what it is. But I had this intuitive sense that there's a certain curriculum you need to learn and overlearn it. And then, of course, Jesus told me I had to overlearn. At first, I thought I got it. I said, I got it now. Okay, where's the peak experience again? It wasn't there. I said, what's going on? I get it. Jesus said, now you got to get it again. I said, come on, get it again. And so that's how it goes. I still haven't got it back. So, yeah, I don't know how long I'll go on. I really don't. I mean, it's loosening up like crazy, but does that mean that the overlearning problem is gone? I don't know. How do you assess that? You know, why waste time trying to assess it? That itself is a waste of time. Trying to predict, you know, I'm going to be enlightened in a year or something. What a waste of time. Forget it. Just overlearn your experience. Overlearn the truth. Overlearn it. Just keep going on that. And you'll get there quicker. So right now, to sum it up, we do need shielding. You do need to know how to shield yourself. We do need help in shielding. There is a massive war taking place. It was launched. The surf, big salvo, just like we saw in like the Desert Storm wars, etc. You know, it's all ready to go, and then it says go, and then all the artillery, the missiles start firing like crazy. And just the bombardment begins. At some point in a war, the bombardment begins. There's usually a blitzkrieg. It's the shock and awe. That's how war works, and the reptilians know how to use psychic warfare. They're very experienced in it. They've got all the top psychic generals know how to wage it, and they carry it out, the blitzkrieg, at an opportune time. The inauguration of the president was the time. It was all set up for that, when people would be most vulnerable to it, you see. And they were, and so that's what happened. And they launched a full scale, you know, assault, bombardment, shock and awe, shock and awe. Because at that inauguration time, we're most vulnerable to trying to get something, trying to connect with some authority, and try to take in their words as our own words. You see, so the reptilians launched that assault. So we'd be bombarded while we're trying to connect with the president and what he has to say and the whole mood and everything, and make it internalize it as ours. We end up then pulling in all these thought forms, psychic thought forms, that we think are ours too. You see, swallow the whole thing. It's like a hook, line, and sinker. You know, you got the fish, you got the bait, and then the bait you have the bait and it's hooked. There's a hook in the bait. So the inauguration, the present, that was the bait, and then within the bait is the hook, and the hook is the psychic assault. So did I watch? Of course not. I didn't watch. Paid zero, no attention whatsoever. I never do, because I know what it's used for. Is what it's used for. Super Bowl, various things, sporting events, a lot of things are used that way. There's bait. There's a hook inside it. So did I watch some of the 49ers games? A little bit, first couple parts. Then I didn't watch the rest of it. Actually came in like on the last play. I think I saw the last play or something. It's better. You gotta be very careful in what you watch. Very careful. And it's better to stay away from events. I stay away from events. It's out of sync a little bit. Oh well. The speech. Don't pay attention to events. Don't try to connect with celebrities. Really, that's the most dangerous thing. Don't try to connect with any celebrities. The best connection is with whatever is helping you overlearn. That's the right connection. In that case, connect with the overlearning. Don't connect. You don't need to connect with the person or anything like that. Connect with the overlearning. Do that. And that is going to help you incredibly. Now, it's the most help you can have, because you say, wait a minute, I don't need that thought form. I'm working on this overlearning. That's not my thought form. That thought form's got nothing to do with overlearning the truth. So it's not part of, not something that's useful to me. So when I got that thought form came, I'm going to die of a heart attack. I'm going to die of a heart attack. I said, hey, I'm busy here. I'm busy. I'm trying to be enlightened. I want to switch hypotheticals, and I haven't got it yet. And this isn't part of that program. So get out of here. I don't want the thought form. It works. It works. It works. It works. It works. So here we go. Almost hit the two hour mark. Yeah. So there you go. You get a special. Right? Aren't the specials like 2 hours? The big specials, the big stuff, you know, the big wheels that are baiting the hook for you. They're baiting the hook. So you get into this receptive, mood of some authority, some celebrity, something you need, really need to receive. And then the psychic thought forms can easily write in on that. It's like the Beatles, like there's a lot of forests in North America that are dying because there's beetles that bore into the trees, and actually on these beetles are these microscopic fungus or something. They use the borer beetles to get into the heart of the tree where the circulation system of the tree is, and then they multiply the fungus or bat whatever in there within the tree, kill the trees. Whole forests are dying because of that. It's like that. It's these celebrities are borer beetles, but you don't realize they're carrying subtle fungus on them, the fungus of psychic thought forms that the ETs are piggybacking on them. So they're carriers of that. And so they bore through your defenses, and then these psychic thought forms get into you, and you think that they're your own thoughts, and then the problems begin. I mean, it really gets problematical. Very problematical. All right. Oh boy, that was really an assault on my voice midway through there. Wow, that was nasty. Really tough. One of the worst I've ever had, really. Which is pressure to shut up. Yeah. All right, very great. Remember, what did you get out of this? Overlearning. So what do you do with your time? Very simple, right? You know how to use your time. Overlearn. That's it. And if you're doing that, you're on the spiritual path. Period. As long as what you're overlearning is the basics, the essential basics, which is what we're emphasizing here. We're not worried about peak experiences and blah, blah. All this, God, spiritual psychobabble. Yeah, it's so extravagant. Such extravagant waste of time. I listen to a lot of spiritual teachers, and they go and always say, oh, whew, man, not for me. You can't break down the minutiae. Well, am I feeling this? And then I really feel kind of like this. And then, oh, God. Go over the basics. Go over the essentials and overlearn them. That's the way. Overlearn the basics. Forget about all your feelings and your thoughts and my feelings. Well, I kind of felt like this. When they said that, I kind of felt like this. And I said, well, were they meaning this, or was it meaning that? Maybe I could have been a little different about that. And I felt some spaciousness. And I thought, oh, blah, 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 blah. Good grief. Go over the basics. Overlearn the basics. Because that's all you need. It's all you need. Eventually, you just overlearn the vision of Christ, which is exquisite beauty, and you'll know exactly why. You'll know the usefulness perfectly well. So, spend time on the basics and overlearn the basics and forget about the rest. There's no usefulness to it. It's extravagant. When I look at a lot of the spiritual paths and teachers and teachings, it's extravagant. It's totally extravagant. It doesn't need to be that extravagant. Very slow, but a lot of waste of time. So there's some help to it, but it's too extravagant. And for today's situation, you can't afford to be that extravagant. You can't afford to waste time. You got to get straight to the basics and be adamant about it and overlearn, overteach, so that students can overlearn, boom, 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 boom. Beat the drum of the basics. You got to be helpful. Because the assault is on. It is now officially on. The tribulation period has begun. It's really begun. The war is on. Again, war starts at the psychic level. And it started. It's already started. We're already into what's today? Tuesday. Third day, essentially. Third day already. So, here we go. You know, circle the wagons. Start overlearning. And my aim is to be more helpful to all of you. So you can really get even more adamant overlearning. Okay? And I'll keep trying to keep broadcasting. We did a couple hours tonight. And you'll see this probably most of you in the morning because so many people here are on the East Coast or other countries, various places around the world. So God bless everyone. Thank you for watching. And you just keep overlearning and know in your heart that is the spiritual path. You're on the spiritual path when you do that. Guarantee. Okay, that's it.